How do you use Apple's developer documentation? In this tutorial, I want to show you how you find the APIs you're looking for, how you can navigate and use the search tools that are integrated to find what you want, and how you can learn from it and get a better understanding of how things are connected. In the first part, I will show you some of the tricks and tips to use the documentation. We will have a search for the documentation, and in the second part, we'll have a little demo. So we will build something really small together. You can use this as a small challenge. And I will, during this demo, I will ask you to look for the solution in the documentation. And since I don't want to make this too easy, I had to pick something that probably not so many people are using. So we are going to have a look at the pencil kit. You can test yourself how much value you can get from the documentation. And I will also show you how I approach searching for things in the documentation. Let's get started by looking at the documentation. So I am here in the page, in the featured page, which I think I don't really use because this is definitely not something I can find things. So on the left side, you have the main navigation. And in the navigator area, you have all the APIs. So we have here app frameworks, and the most important, I guess, is UIKit and Swift UI here. Okay, maybe also Swift and Foundation and AppKit. Then we have app services. So for example, CloudKit, Combine, CoData. It's not usually, you probably won't use it from this side unless you really know where it is. Then we have developer tools, graphics and games. So here, core graphics, core animation, and then pencil kit. We're going to have a look at later. Some media, some systems. So let's say I'm looking for a UI view. You have the possibility to here go for UI kit and then expand this navigator area and then scroll down to the point where you see a view, like UI view. When you're tapping on UI kit, the page for UI kit for the UI kit framework opens, but you also have here on the top, very top left of the page, you also have here a small UI kit field. And if you click on this, you see the same list as we had on the left navigator. And this is actually a little bit faster sometimes to navigate. And here you can also, from UIKit, go for all the submenus and use one more submenu. Maybe I should use something that is actually useful. So we go for, you see here under user interfaces, we have views and controls. And here under controls, I have UI control, UI button, UI color wheel. It is a lot of things. Maybe I hope you can see still a little bit. So the idea is you have a lot of information in these three columns here. If I put one more, which helps you to have a better overview of so many things. So you can click on UI control. The next place to find something is up here on the search toolbar. So you can use here UI view. So I have selected Swift. Usually it's the first one is suggested and highlighted. And the more important thing is to look on the right which framework this is under. So this is UIKit. But you see we also have here a dismantle UI view for Swift UI. UI view animating or UI view controller. If I instead of UI view would have typed here view. The first one is Swift UI because it assumes if you have no UI, it means Swift UI. Since some of the frameworks, maybe I close this, are organized in a way that you have a prefix like here in core image. You can use for CI image, maybe I should use something in core animations, like core animations CA layer. So if you would search for layer, the first result is in ML compute because I didn't use a CA, but going down, we have here core animations and down here you see CA layer. That's why it's usually good to start with the right if you already know where it is or the concrete name. And if you type CA layer, then the first result is the one that you are looking for in core animations. So going back, I can press here this back button. I want to go back to UI controls. So you have here this three ways of main navigation, your navigation area, here this quick jumps between two different ones instead of scrolling here endlessly. And then the more detailed, fine-grained, depending on what you selected. It's quite convenient to use this one to further navigate or to directly go to the place that you know, to the view or to our UI control view that I'm here looking for. If we want to search something in a page, like in our control view, you can use a different search. So if you can type command F and you see here another search toolbar coming up. And in this case, for UI control, you would maybe look for the background, which it does not exist. Maybe I should use something. I might want to search for something target action related. So I'm here going, the first one is in my description, which if you are the first time seeing this, should read. And this is UI control is quite, it's been around for a while, so there is more description for this one. It's also very important because it's used for others. Okay, maybe I just press on next. And so it brings me directly to the section where it talks about add target. So target membership. So now let's have a look at how this page is composed. So you have a small description on the top, and if it's a class, how it's declared, and then an overview of the mechanisms. Sometimes they have some images, like here you see these three different ones. Then here you have some fast tracks on the right side. So we are right now on the declaration part. You can also, then we have the overview part, and then you can skip to topics. And here, usually you see all the customization of this view. So you can check if this control view is enabled. Clicking on it, you can see that this property is get set, so you can change it also. You have here all kinds of properties, function calls for this object. You also have here initializers, properties, methods. And down here you have inheritance. You can see which class this one inherits from. So this is UI view. If you click on UI view and I scroll down, so that's the thing. Actually, for me, this is one of the important things sometimes. So if you scroll down, we see that our UI view inherits from UI responder. And you see here the protocol this is conforming to. So it's hashable, it's equatable, for example. So maybe I go back. So if I go back on the top, so this is the main part. On the right, you have here another important things. So I did select here Swift, switch to Objective-C, but you can also do that here on the left side to go to Objective-C. Then the important thing is here this availability. So which iOS versions or does it support? And in this case, this is a UI view, so it's pretty long around since iOS 2. Mac Catalyst only is available since 13, so this is clear, it's there only like this. And then we have UI Kit. So if I have a look at a Swift UI view, and then maybe I go. So, because this is the beginning, you always have different ways of navigating down. So if you use your views and controls and then views. So this is different because this is a protocol. Swift UI is more protocols. What I'm actually looking for is you see here the availability 13 plus. And This can be also different for the properties. So this is the availability of this base class or this protocol or the struct, whatever you're having a look at here. Just going back to the UI control view. Probably shouldn't switch so much. And this is around since iOS 2. And we have quite a bit of description. Then I'm going here to UI button. And this is also quite old from your iOS 2. Sometimes you have here these yellow boxes or red boxes, and they're quite important to read because they might save you from some bugs. If we have here a UI button, one of the important things is now you see that this UI button does inherit from UI control. So you can click on this one and see, because the UI button does inherit from the functionalities from UI control, so it's an easy way of seeing what's available. If you scroll down, and for example, one of the common things is to change the title of this button. So we see here that we have a title label. And if you click on this, this has a different availability. This is available from iOS 3. So properties can be added later. Unfortunately, you only see that when you navigate inside of the property. And in this case, the important thing is that this is only a get property. If you want to change the title of the, it is a var, you can actually set it, but it does not affect the UI button directly. And then you would need to use here the set title for function call. So this, I'm just saying this because quite often this happened to me that I forgot about the set title. If you scroll down, you see here that there one of these properties is a enum. So if you click on this, in order to understand better what this property actually does, it's good to read the name. So this is a button role. And we have here four cases. It's a normal button, it's a primary button, it's a cancel button, and it's a destructive. This is also quite new, so this is from iOS 14. And it makes it easier for... It does change the button role or the display style. Sometimes you need to navigate quite far down. It's going back. So now we go to UI color well. And this is very new. The whole class is added just for iOS 14. And in this case, we have a sparse documentation. There's not a lot of information here. We only have a control that displays a color picker. We have here these three properties, but I don't really know what's going on. If you have the situation that there's not a lot of information, there's another trick where you can find more. And I'm just creating here a small project, so we can also use that for the challenges at the end. This is an app. This is a Swift UI app because I don't like storyboards. And if you set it like this, you are directly getting rid of the storyboards, even if you use UIKit. So I'm just going to create here a new group. This is my UIKit test. And I'm creating here a view controller. So this is a CocoaTouch class. This is a drawing. And I'm here also creating a zip file. So we said we have a UI color. Well, maybe I should not have skipped this too much. So one important thing is now you see here the control that displays a color picker. So this is the information that you get from the documentation. So now I have here a color picker. If you option click on the UI color well, you will see the same description as from the documentation. So this is exactly the same. Which you now rightfully say this is not really helpful. But the trick, if you now comment click and use jump to definition, you will see some parts of the implementation that they expose. In this case, they are usually less strict of the kind of information they put in the in this part. Sometimes the documentation is empty, but if you jump to definition, you see a lot more. So we have here our three properties. We have the title, And it says should explain the kind of color to pick. So fill color, stroke color. And here we have this first property we didn't know yet before what it is. Supports alpha, which means that if it's no, we cannot use opaque colors or half transparent colors. And the last property is the selected color. And now it's getting interesting because if I have a color picker, I obviously want to know when this changes this property. And here it's telling me sets the selected color on the color picker and is updated when the user changes the selection. So this is nice. And we have does support KVO and does send UI control events value changed. So if I go back, we had here color picker dot selected color. And here you see the same description again that we had before. If you type during typing, you see this description. If you option click, you would see the documentation hints, which is empty, so you wouldn't get the information from there. Sometimes it's just easier to jump to the definition and see all of them together. So, well, let's just test this for now. So I would change my color pickers title, select background color, and now I'm going to add this color picker to myself. So self.view to my view controller, self.view.add subview, which is my color picker. Let's say we want to change this, the background of this view controller, and we just learned about KVU. So I can use here a observer pattern published for, and I'm using here a combine for this property. This is my selected color dot sync. This is value, and maybe I'm just going to set it to the background color of my view controller. So this is my views background color, is this value, and this is self, this is weak self. I'm just using combine because it's a lot faster for me. And I need to keep the subscription. So this is var subscriptions. This is a set of any cancel. Ah, importing combine. And then I need to store this in my subscriptions. So just by digging a little bit deeper in the documentation, I was able to set this here. You can try this. And I probably should set my color pickers selected color to my views background color. And just putting it in the middle somewhere. In the scene delegate, instead of my UI hostings controller, I use the view controller that I just generated. And this is my drawing view controller. So now we have this small color wheel. We tap on it and I can click here on one color, and you see I directly change the background color of my view. It's sometimes necessary to dig a little bit in the documentation, especially if it's so new, like a color picker, the color wheel, the UI color wheel. Now I want to show some example for Swift UI, because it does look a little bit different. If I tap here on view, a Swift UI view is a protocol. So if I scroll down to my relationships, I have here inherited by. You see here that, for example, a UI view controller representable inherits from this protocol. And we also have the conforming types. So what other UI elements in Swift UI do conform to view? And interesting enough, for example, you have here a color. So a color is a view. A color picker, we have this one again. We have dividers is a view. We have for each is a view. And for each, it's a bit more complicated because you have here some more restrictions. And if you tap on it, we also have this here below the initializer in this example, available. So this is available when data is range. We have a lot more generics in Swift UI, and you can see this here. So you can here very easily in this conformance see what kind of views you have and navigate further from there. So if we go here for each. You see here the functions to delete, to insert, and you have here two different ones. And you might be like, oh, they're the same, but now we click on one of them. On the off perform, you have here the availability, and this is deprecated. And only until 14.3 available. So this one is not the good one. If I use the other one, the first one, this is the replacement, which means that it's available for iOS 14. So you have this three versions, 14 until 14.3, where you can use both. But ideally, you would go with this one as the new one. So it's quite important to have a look at which one you should use, because if you use the other one, you would run into trouble now with iOS 14.4. Unfortunately, you need to navigate in these areas to see which ones you are more new. Sometimes they are actually crossed out when they're decorated fully. So that might be a little bit more easy than you already see it in this list overview. So now we had here a little bit of Swift UI and UI kit. The other thing is, if you scroll down, it might look a little bit overwhelming. So let's say I'm here in the graphics and games department, and you have here metal and core image, core graphics and core animation. And it's like, what are they belonging to each other? Actually, this is unfortunately, they don't really show that so easily. So if I click here on core animation, and this overview is, for more details, see this guide. So sometimes they have links to guides. If I open this, I see here a older documentation. And sometimes in these cases, you see a little bit more of this Objective-C. The most interesting part is actually this little information overview, which helps you to understand the different APIs. So we have here on the very, because they are stacked into each other. So on the very low level, on the lowest level, we have the graphics hardware, which I never touched. Then we have metal and core graphics. And on top of that, you have C core animations. And on top of that, you have UI kit and app kit. And one level higher, which is not in this graphics, is Swift UI. So they are not independent. You can see some traces where one API is used in another one. So to illustrate that, we have on the very top Swift UI and then go down to core graphics. I'm going to navigate there now. So let's say I want to have a image in UI in Swift UI. So I search, I take the first one with Swift UI, and you have here one initializer with UI image. We click on UI image. Now we are in UI image. So we are one level down. They just use it directly in Swift UI because it's such a convenient class. So UI image is related to UI image view, which is a UI view. So if I click on UI view, what a UI view has, or the part that is actually responsible for drawing and this animation, is based on core animation and core graphics below. And you can see this by looking for a CA layer in the search. So here you have under configuration, the visual part, a CA layer property. And we can navigate to CA layer, and we are in core animation. If I go back to my UI view, we just have a look at the properties that are defined here. You see we have a alpha, which is CG for core graphics. This is some sipping foo. We have CG rect. And you can also see this more if we have a look at the drawing function, because I said it's something done with draw. So it is under drawing and updating the view. And this is a draw in rect function that you can override if you want to do some drawings by yourself. And what you have to talk to is the CG context. Okay, let's try in the UI view the context. Here in the view drawings lifecycle, we have this draw function and the graphics context. So if you click on this one, you can look here for the current context. And this is in CG context, and this is in core graphics. If you scroll down, we have here some parts where you can define a path. So we have here this CG core graphics types like CG point, which are also in CG rec, which you can also see in UKit and in SwiftUI. And these functions are pretty much the same as they used for the new one for SwiftUI now. I think it's nearly the same names and the same definitions. So they're basically reusing this ones, or this, the SwiftUI paths is based on the core graphics paths, which is quite nice because then you don't have to learn things again. We will now continue working on this little project and using the documentation only. And what I want to add is I want to have a little drawing image, drawing field. So I'm going to search here for pencil. And the first thing that comes up is actually pencil kit. The important part is that you have here a PK canvas view, which inherits from UI scroll view. There's also a delegate method to use. If you scroll further down, we have here a tool. So you can either have a eraser inking or lasso tool, so you can move things. Just going to go back. Yeah, you have here also, you can also check if the ruler is active. Then we have here one deprecated method, which is allowing finger drawing. So this is a Boolean value that you can get and set. But since this is deprecated, we need to check what other thing is there. And you see here we have this drawing policy and this enum drawing policy. If you click on this, you see that we have a default. This is the default. We have any input. This is the finger drawing, and we have pencil only. So this is the new one, which is available for iOS 14 and later. Actually, before I started this, I was checking before a tutorial from Ray Wunderlich about pencil kit. And this is one of the things that is usually missing with tutorials, the discussion of, oh, this is only available for this and this version. And he did the same. They simply ignored iOS 13 and they noted in the beginning that it's only working for iOS 14. So at some point you have to go to the documentation and check. But like this, you definitely see what's going on and what you have to move things. And then the important thing is the getting the captured data from the drawing, the PK drawing. So we have to go deeper. It's good to always have a look at the initializers. So you have here a empty drawing object. We could use that to clear our drawing. Just set it to an empty one. And we also have an initializer from data, which we'll come back to later. You can also create an image from a drawing. Then we have here strokes. If you click on this, this is new. And before I go, if you have a look, I was already jumping here because I know a little bit. But in this case, it's nice because here you see this, since it's a bigger thing, we have here also smaller sites, sub pages. And in this case, they have a sample project that is worth downloading. And this is actually the sample project they used in this session. So it's a good idea. In this case, it's really nice that they added some links. Some of these APIs have that. And I think it's also in this one, there's another one, Meet Scribble for iPad. And inspect, modify, and construct pencil kit drawing. This is in your presentation. So I was having a look at PK canvas view. And I go back to my drawing. So we had here strokes, which are newer because you can get the single strokes where exactly the user drew. And we have here a nice little function, which is data representation, giving a data. Then there is some appending, so you can stack multiple drawings together. You can also transform, you can scale down drawings if that's of your interest. And here you see the conformance to decodable and uncodable, which makes it also easier to work with this data here, or I guess that's how they use it. Going back to the PK canvas view. I think this is most of it. So let's just have a look at how to implement this. And one thing you probably wouldn't know how to do is how to create one, because this is not normal. So you go in your drawing view controller, we need to import pencil kit, saving this, then in the zip file, I can add here a UI view. And then in the inspector, in the identify inspector, I can make this here a PK canvas view, or a custom class PK canvas view. Since I want to see this, I'm just going to change the color to here a light gray. So I'm not going to do any auto-layered constraints. I'm adding here a button, which we can use to clear, and a text field, text view actually. Then I'm going to create outlets to my view controller. Control dragging. I didn't do that for a long time actually, clear. I mean, I don't do that so often. Pressed. This is a action call. And then the canvas. This is a canvas. And the text field, text view. So I can close the storyboard. So one thing that we just saw is that we have each canvas has a drawing property. So for example, in the clear button, we can say that our canvas is drawing, and this is a PK canvas, PK drawing. And we can clear that with saying PK drawing and an empty one. So if you run this, you have here a drawing field, which I didn't add a finger touch to, because the default behavior is not to draw with your finger. And we already saw that there was two versions. We had here this allow finger drawing property that is deprecated, and the drawing policy depending on the version. So if available iOS 14 and higher, then I can use the new one, which is this policy. This is the drawing policy, and this is any input else. So for versions below, I can set the canvases allow finger drawing to true. So now if I can draw here, and because I set it here as empty, you can press on clear and it's gone. Then the next question is, we just saw here some nice things about this drawing, PK drawing, with data. So how do you save this to the file system without looking at Stack Overflow? So you can try by yourself. I did Google that a couple of times, but I will try to do it without it this time. So I know that I need to use the file manager, which is in the foundation framework. So we use the default one, and we can check where to get the URL. So in my view that you load, I can use the file manager default contents of contents at path. And now we need to construct actually a URL, and I need to use this two times. So I'm creating a function URL, which returns a optional URL. And we again can have a look how to get the function of location system directory. And this is URL for directory and user domain mask. This is again the file manager dot default dot URL for documents directory, which usually if you're there, user domain mask. So this is leaflet URL. And I'm only using the first one that I'm returning here. And I can append a path component, which is drawing in my case. and I can return this, and else I'm returning here nil, return URL. So now I have a URL that I can load. If let URL is URL, then I can get the contents of this URL's path. This is data, and I can create a we just saw and the documentation. If I go back to PK drawing, that I can hear that I have an initializer from data. This is PK drawing data, which froze. So I can use here a do catch block. So this is my canvas's drawing. I will try to set to this new one. Otherwise, I'm just going to print here the error. And this shouldn't be optional, so I'm just going to add this here to my if let statement. Now I'm able to load it, but I didn't save it yet. So I have here, similar to creating a drawing, we saw that I can get here a data representation for my PK drawing. So my canvas's drawing has a data representation that gives me a data. So this is let data that I could use to save it to the file system. But the problem is, when should I do that? Ideally, I want to do that every time I have a stroke. So if we go back to the pencil kit and to the PK canvas view, we have here a delegate method, and usually with UI kit you are looking for delegate methods, not for methods, because you want to have a callback. So if you click then on these PK canvas delegate, I can inspect all these delegate methods, and one of them is canvas view drawing the change. And if you conform to this, you also conform to scroll view delegate, which means that you can also have this scroll view, the scroll callbacks if you want to, or scroll view did end dragging or zooming. Okay, maybe I should go back. And it also means that you can set all these zooming options, because by default it's not zoomable. So especially with these delegates, it's usually worth digging a little bit deeper. Okay, I want to use this PK canvas delegate. PK canvas view delegate. So my view did load. I should also make myself actually the delegate. So canvas views delegate is me, self. And I shouldn't do that in the here. I can now get this method call, which was canvas view did change. And here from this canvas view. I can get the drawings data representation. So this is called every time I have a new stroke. So I have now a data and the opportunity to save it. So I get the URL again, if let URL. So how do I write it to a file? You can try to search for write data. And the closest is NS data. So NS is a older Objective C based, and you see here also the important, we should use data, and also on the top here in the navigation we have data, so I can also go there to data and search for write. And here under reading and writing data we have a function from data that is write to URL with options, so I can say data.write to URL. This froze, so do try catch, and I'm printing here the error. So now I should be able to save it and also to load it every time. So I begin with an empty one again, so I'm just going to add something here and then we start again, and you see my little drawing, amazing as it is still there. Sometimes just searching here in the navigator area, and also in the usually when you look for something you already know half what you need, Like I already knew half that I need a file manager. As another test, I want to have this floating button here, this floating toolbar thing. So you could have a look at the example, but I already know that I have here this tool. There's a tool picker. Maybe I go back to Pencil Kit. Here, this is the tool palette. And here it tells me I have to set it visible. If you scroll down, because we need to create one, it tells me here creating a new picker. And if you click on this, we see again, this is only, we can only use this initializer for iOS 14 plus. And that's also why you have here this decorated one again, because this is the old way of creating this is the iOS 13 version of creating a PK tool picker. So this is another one of these adjustments. And in this case, for the shared one, we actually have to start with the window one. So if in my view that load, already have here two ways of doing this. I already have this if iOS 14. So I'm just going to do this for iOS 14 right now. This was a little bit easier, PK tool picker. You can just create like one like this. Let picker. Then let's have a look again what I'm supposed to do. We need to set it visible for first responder. Picker, don't set visible. Yes, I want to have this visible. And I need to connect it to a first responder. This is my canvas. So basically this says, whenever the canvas is the first responder, I want to see this tool picker. And this tool picker is actually a class and I need to keep a reference of it. This is another view. Is it actually a view? It is an NS object. It's not actually a view. But I don't see the view. So this is a var tool. This is a PK tool picker, optional. So I'm creating here one. I'm setting this self.tool to the picker that I created here. And if you have a look again in the documentation, it says detecting changes to the picker. Add observer, add specific objects to the list of objects that to notify when the picker configuration changes. So I want, if I have this picker that I connected to my canvas, I need to let the canvas know when something changed. So we use this add observer. So picker.addObserver, my canvas. And actually when I load, my canvas will not be the first responder. So I need to tell my canvas to become first responder. So now you see this nice little toolbar here. It's not floating. On the iPhone, it's just a big bar on the bottom. If you're on the iPad, on the larger, not a split screen, in the larger full screen, you will see this floating button. So you can how here change things and add nice elements and draw and erase. You can also use this eraser tool here. To finish this, sometimes it takes some time to get used to the developer documentation, but if you understand, if you have some fundamental understanding of classes, properties, protocols, delegation, or initializers, how to create one of these, how they're related to each other, when you're reaching this level of understanding, I think it's a great tool to work with the documentation. It can actually save you time because you are directly at the source, so you see the newest version, the newest information, which doesn't mean that I'm not using tutorials. It's just, it is a combination of both of them. Let me know in the comments if I could convince you to use the documentation more. If you have any suggestions or more tricks for using, please share them. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Until next time, happy coding.